I would like to introduce Dr. Lal, my friend and colleague from Ohio State University. He's a distinguished university professor of soil science. He also manages our Carbon Management and Sequestration Center. He is an expert on soil, but actually soil is a part of a larger ecosystem, and he has studied extensively the relationships between soil, the atmosphere, the water cycle, and the movement of carbon through the environment. And also, he is the president of the International Union of Soil Sciences, which he told me has 65,000 members. So he's recognized around the world and in India as one of the premier experts in this field. Please welcome Dr. Lal.
Than the fertilizer added onto the land. That's a serious issue, a very serious issue. If we were to reverse that trend, that has to happen. And the health of the children in unregulated condition, the health of the young mothers, the health of the unborn babies inhaling those fumes. Think about that. The biogas plants in India certainly have increased about 500,000. We need a lot more millions of those biogas plants so that the dung is converted into biogas. So the slurry is fortified with fertilizer, put in nutrient back on the land where it belongs. Then we enter our refugees. We are blessed. We are blessed in excellent land, the best land I've ever had. We have it. Therefore, we produce a lot of grains. In addition to grain, we produce 620 million tons of residue, crop residues. What happens to the crop residue? Taken to feed the cattle. What happens to the cattle dung? It's dried to cook the food. What happens to the land? It's fed to fend itself. Everything we grow on the land is taken away from the land. And therefore the land rebels. And when the land rebels, it does not grow nutritious food. It grows food which has little micronutrients. Because we took them away. Because we wasted them away. We burn the crop residues. When we harvest the wheat, we harvest the rice in October. We must plant the wheat immediately in Punjab, Haryana, UP. We cannot plant that without burning. Burning the residue is causing this smoke. That smoke is what causes the plane not to be able to land. The first smoke, the Himalaya, do you know what color it is? Black. Well, the smoke. 100 million tons of crop residues are burned in the field. You take the satellite image of the lower Himalayas, smoke. Take the satellite image of the Arabian Sea, it has a brown cloud, which has changed the monsoon. The frequency, the intensity, the energy balance, the climate change. And this polluted air breathed by more than 900 million people. The impact on health, health of the babies, is enormous, tremendous. Something we cannot ignore. Agricultural crop residue burning is a serious environmental problem with severe adverse effects on the pulmonary issues. We have to address them. We cannot simply have slogans. We have to have action. City of Mumbai, beautiful. There's a spa in the rivers of Mumbai. How much of the refuse? We heard that many times this morning. I showed you how much that was. City of Mumbai produces 10,000 tons of garbage a day. That comes to 4 million tons per year. City of 1.7 million people, that's a half a kilogram per person per day. Even if we do not collect half of it, that's quite a lot to be not collected. Compared to that, the United States have 4 tons per person more garbage. But it is collected. But the difference, collecting and not collecting. Chandigarh, Bombay, Amritsar, Agra, all cities, the per capita collection, dung production, the waste production, is somewhere between a half and 2 kilograms per person per day and increasing. But not being collected. India generates 50 million tons of municipal solid waste in year 2000. Only 50% collected. Over 90% of the collected waste are taken to landfill or unbiodegradable to methane. And to go, methane is 21 times global warming potential compared to CO2. And you are 310 times. When you go to the restaurant, you don't eat all the food you order. It goes into the waste fall. I think you should pay double the price. A, wasting food. B, taking it to landfill. C, emitting methane and nitrous oxide. Who should pay? The sinner pays. The polluter pays. We must pay that. And you know how much waste we have? India, with the blessed largest amount of rainfall, I'll give you a figure in a minute, suffers from the drought, flood, syndrome. During the dry season, no water. During the rainy season, too much water. Why? Because you do not manage it properly. When it falls, you do not take care of it. Elite and semi-elite agriculture suffer from this. Even Shirapunji, with 500 inches of rainfall a year, does not have a water to drink during the 1 month of dry season. Because we cannot take care of it. Yet the total precipitation received in the Arab country is 4,000 cubic kilometers. If we manage that properly, we can also serve the adjacent nations who are not equally blessed. We learned two things from Mahajadara: how to make bricks. You can compare the bricks we make now and from the Mahajadara, exactly the same thing. We also learned the flood irrigation 5,000 years ago, the same flood irrigation now, since 5,000 years later. This is wheat, it's not rice. Wheat is aerobic plant. The nose of wheat is the roots. The mouth of plant is the background. We turn that plant, we water board that plant every 2 weeks by flood irrigation, the most backward thing. In a dry climate, in a erratic climate, you put flood irrigation, what's going to happen in the groundwater? Falling 1 meter every year since the tubal started. You cannot recharge it. Wasteful irrigation. And then the mother changes, the mother Yamuna. Of course, the industrial fluence have to go into it. The river that came from the jet of Shiva receives the nutrients coming from everything else. This is where we have to recycle the water. There are at least four types of water. And the river water, the ground water, the rain water. You have water, which is over the grain, black water. Grain water, the human contaminant. The black water, the human feces in it. Somehow the city water, I heard so many media people today, have to be converted back into green water. Green water the plants use. That recycling part has to happen in every city. That's where I said 20% of the food that we grow in this city is to be eaten in the city by recycling the nutrients which are not allowed today. To be put into that purpose. Then we have virtual water. The water is embedded in the produce, the corn, for example, the wheat, the soybean, when you export that out of a given state or a region, the water required is exported with it. We don't want to waste that water. When we grow wheat, rice, and we accumulate in an unsheltered container at 5 million tons of it, the figure I have is 30 million tons every year, then it rots, it's a crime against nature. That water, nutrients, use the energy used to grow in the creation. It's a crime. Cannot be forgiven. Especially if hundreds of millions, and I give that figure to them, have to stop eating without food a day. The dilemma of food insecurity, 1992, 210 million people didn't have food, 2286, 234, 2012, 190 million. Right now, almost 200 million, more hungry people in India alone than in sub-Saharan Africa. And yet, we are the largest producer of grains. The mountains of grains rotting that was sitting in front of it. What happened to the policy? Why is the nature being wasted from that point of view? We have a food production. At least 25 to 40% of it more than what we need. But 50% of what we produce is wasted. It never reaches its stomach. Post-harvest losses are tremendous of each crop. It does not matter which crop you take. The bananas and fruits and vegetables, same thing. 51 million tons of bananas and fruit wasted every year. Rotting grains. You drive through the countryside of Western UP, Haryana, Punjab, from miles you can smell that. Even cattle will not eat it. The dilemma is that the beggar sitting in front of it, they cannot access it either. We have to think about those policies. We cannot be a great nation when we waste resources in that fashion. We cannot. Very important that hunger in the time of plenty. Because the global hunger index, India, like 55 of the 120 nations, hungriest nation. Despite success in food availability and being one of the world's largest grain producers, about 20% of the total population is food insecure. That's a tragedy. Both GDP and food grain production have risen faster than the growth in population over the last 50 years, and yet malnutrition remains to be such a serious problem that 46% of the children malnourished, 50% of the women are anemic, and number of poor people living in India, 78 million in the urban and under 250 million in the rural areas. In spite of the tremendous resources which cannot be matched anywhere, it's hard to explain that statistics. Very hard. I mean, one part which I'd like to mention is the health of soil, plants, animals, people, and ecosystem is one and indivisible. You cannot separate them. If you mistreat your soil, taking away the dung and the cattle and do not nourish the microbes under that soil will not feed the people who eat the food that it grows. And that is simple. All that can be composted, recycled, put back in the land, so the cycle of health is continuing. We have energy of crop residue that we burn, tremendous amount of energy. Each tons of that is somewhere 15 to 18, 20 megajoules per kilogram. All that burned, all that creating pollution rather than harvesting it. We have 620 million tons of crop residue, 34% 210, which can produce an energy value of 4 exajoules. Tremendous amount of energy. Definitely waste. Rice, a very important crop. It produces 144 tons of paddy, 155 tons in 2014, 60 tons of rice husk, 6 tons of rice hash. But in reality, there's a rice made in any village in Haryana, Punjab, or India. All that amount of rice husk burned in place so that you can be done. India produces 122 million tons of rice per year, 125,000 rice players. Every ton of paddy produces 230 kilograms of rice husk, 40 kilograms of rice hash. The reason I mention is that rice hash is full of elements which have a tremendous industrial value for cement production rather than bricks from soil, ethanol, biofuel production, energy production, heating value, 15 megajoule per kilogram, the combustion or gasification, reactive silica, silica gel, silica chips, activated silica, all kind of industries, zeolites, everything can be made from it. It's a bad adaptation. It requires realizing that that's a real wealth. It requires an important thing to understand, you just can't learn it. And that's an issue. Plant nutrients. We burn 25% of agriculture organic, all that organic nutrients being recycled, not being recycled, being thrown and being burned. And the societal value of carbon if you have to put back in the land is $120 per ton. The United Nations will accept that. World Bank will accept that. Tremendous wealth that can be generated from that. But undervaluing the resources which we got used to it is that what leads to society of commerce. And therefore, the issue really of land degradation in India, a very serious problem. Because we ignore the undervalue that resource. And because of that, I think there's a law of return, and you will hear from in a moment who put that law of return. The law of return says that the nutrients harvested from soil must be returned. Harvesting without returning is a robbery of the soil, a banditry, a particularly mean form of banditry, because it involves robbing of future generations, which are not able to defend themselves. The person who read that was Albert Howard. Yesterday I met somebody, he said he was from Indore. Sir Albert Howard in 1920 was a medical doctor in Indore. It was he who dwelt the Indore company. compost pit. And it was he who made that statement, the health of soil plants and animal people is one and invisible. It was who realized that human and animal feces not collected properly eventually affect the human health. And that's why taking those away and now recycling is mandatory. I want to end, I know the time is running up, I'm going to end quickly, but first sharing with you, Swachh Bharat came from Gandhiji. I want to quote some of him saying, what he said, humanity is sin, wealth without work, pleasure without conscience, knowledge without character, commerce without morality, politics without principle, how nice, religion without sacrifice, and science without humanity. Think about that, science without humanity. I would like to share with you statistics of India, but I just presented what we have per day, and that is births per day, 41,000. Deaths from hunger per day in India, 27,500. Infant mortality less than 5 years old, 1,000. 3. Urban growth in 1,000 per day, 255,000. New motor vehicles, great, 44,000 per day. Every day, 685 million a day from topsoil. Fresh water withdrawal every day, so we can flood our wheat out. 2 kilometer cube carbon dioxide emission every day. That does not include burning of crop residue. So we pour 7 million tons a day. Post-harvest grain losses every day, 88,000 tons. Loss of fruits and vegetables every day, 140,000 tons. Dung burning for cooking every day, 690,000 tons. Crop residue burning every day, 271,000 tons. Rice husk production every day and burning, 74,000 tons. If Gandhi were to see that statistics, I wonder whether he would change those laws. I think you would have. I believe you that we that he should have. And if he did, what law would he make? I really have no idea. I think one of the laws he would have said is sin, technology without wisdom. I think that is one. Education without relevance. Look at the curricula in our universities. Do they address the questions we have? Of the next generation. I think we would have also said humanity without conscience. How can we have so many sleeping, hungry stomach when everything is so much wasted? Joseph, India has religions, each and every religion in the world. If we were to really reach the masses, we really have to go back to our priests. We have Judaism. We have Christianity, we have Islam, we have Sikhism, everything. In each and every scripture, the nature is worship. Let me give you an example. Judaism, the word homo, man, is derived from the Latin word humus. Humus, organic matter in the soil. Or the decomposed organic matter in the soil, which is a sense of all crusted life. The Hebrew phrase tikkun olam means the repairing, restoring the world. Hinduism. Shiti, Jal, Pavak, Gagan, Samira, Panch, Tattva, Ahatam, Sharira. Human body is made of those five tattva. Sikhism, my friend is there, Paun, Guru, Pani, Ila, Mahabha, Dhaka, Mahabha. Beautiful. Who doesn't get anything bad? It's greatest in Mother of Quran. Buddhism, one should not break into the branch of a tree, but give yourself to Christianity. The word Adam, it derived from the Hebrew word Adma, meaning earth, soil. Greek, the daughter of the goddess Hera, named Themis, goddess of law. And I presented the Nether, the goddess of ambiguous and fertility. Romans, the earth goddess Paris, was related to the goddess of fertility and harvest, Sears, and Matthew Terra, Sanskrit. Islam. He created the man. may not feel like potters. Solomon, verse 14. We made from water every living thing. Quran, verse 25-54. Do not overuse water even if you live on a running river. Prophet Muhammad. Khalid Gibran, American Leibniz. I think he wrote the best. Trees are points or way up that earth rises up from the sky. We fell them down and then turned them to paper so that we may require our emptiness. I think we take these spiritual and tell our people, it doesn't matter which one of the religions you belong to, just follow faithfully. You will realize that God has given us the blessing of water, the earth, and air, and polluting them is a sin. That is being Godism, I'd rather believe either one of them, all of